I apologize if I look at my phone, so I wasn't able to print anything off. But we'll get started here. Thanks, Lauren. All right, so here for the overview, we're going to talk about what the club is, how it came about, and how it's structured. We're going to talk about what they believe in, the largest piece of work that they put out, the limits to growth book that they publish, and we're going to talk about their importance as well. So what is the Club of Rome? The Club of Rome is a group of futurists who systematically try to predict the economic and environmental conditions of the future. They're also nonpartisan, so they try to have as little political affiliation as possible. And what they do is they try to catalyze new policy initiatives and more public debates in order to create more awareness of global concerns and issues for future generations. Their official statement is to promote understanding of the interdependent global system in which we all live and to bring this understanding to the attention of policymakers. So a little history on the club. This is the founder, Aurelio Pecci. He founded it in 1968. He started off as an economist for the car company Fiat. And while he was doing some work in Argentina, he felt that he was a little limited just by being in the type of industrial position he was with his company. So he decided to go on his own and invest in manufacturing locally in Argentina there, separately. And he actually went back to have a meeting with some of the investors that were trying to promote industrialization in the area as well. And he caught the attention of Senator State Dean Rusk, who was able to translate his speech from Spanish and circulated throughout the US, which caught the attention of his future partner, Alex Stone, who we'll talk about. After he got a lot of attention, they got some funding for research. Let's see, this is from the Accademia dei Lincei in Rome. And this was an Italian science academy that was founded in 1608. After this funding, they decided to have a meeting of about 30 industrialists and scientists around the globe. But prior to that, they decided to independently study and educate themselves on global topics beforehand. Structure. There was some debate when they were starting the club whether to focus on the entire globe as a whole system or the nation of Italy as a subsystem. And the founder, Pecci, decided to go with the more humanitarian aspect of the globe as one larger system that our human subsystems depend on. Whether they're socially or politically, they're all going to be dependent upon the environment and the climate conditions of the Earth. They also wanted to keep membership low to less than 100 official international members. That way they wouldn't have to worry about anything clerical or having secretaries or anything like that. They wanted to follow the structure of Lunar Society of Birmingham, which is an interesting dinner club who met on the first Monday of the month, closest to the full moon, that way the roads were better late at night. And they didn't have any political affiliations or power, but they just met to discuss the global issues going on. They saw the potential for change in the nature of society. So the global problematique is something that the founder Pecci coined, and this is what he uses to describe all of the just general economic and environmental problems that the entire globe is facing. And he decided that the globe's vision would be to combat this, the global problematique, with an effort of sustainability. And with preaching global sustainability and incorporating sustainable methods, we would be able to reach an equilibrium between the population growth as well as our natural resources. We would be able to balance them. And I'll save the beliefs for the last slide because they're really interesting, but their interests include, the protection of the environment, economic sustainability, peace building and conflict resolution, gender equality and protection of women and children from abuse, and the general future of the entire global system. And this is an example of one interdependent system would look like. This is the approach that they would take to just the entire globe. They would take all aspects of the problem and how they would relate to one another in order to develop a theory that would meet the demands of the present while not compromising the future. Alumnus Growth is the first book that they put out. It was their largest work so far, and they used a lot of mathematical equations and dynamic modeling to predict the conditions of the future in 10, 20, and 50 year periods. It initially was rejected a lot and demonized, I think partly because of the labeling of the graphics. It wasn't very inviting, and it predicted the economic collapse of a lot of global economies, which wasn't a very popular idea. And these approaches to the methods were, at the time, considered more American ideologies, and with the Vietnam War going on, there wasn't a very good association with those ideas. So it wasn't accepted at first, but they made a very good case for using scenario building to predict future events and how to manage our resources in order to incorporate sustainability. And after the rejection, it's getting a lot more attention recently, 40 years after it was published, just because of the level of accuracy that they had depicting the type of downfall and challenges that we would face. This is a nicer graphic. This is kind of an overview of the whole book. All of their data they compiled, they basically were able to conclude that at the rate our population's increasing and the rate of our consumption of our natural resources, they took into account oil, minerals, and gas, as well as our population growth. They saw how that would affect our population over time and when we would reach our carrying capacity to where the Earth could no longer support our level of consumption, which is alarmingly close considering the amount of time we have to prepare. The importance of this club is it teaches us not to discount the future, to meet the needs of the present while taking into account the future challenges we'll face. It allows us to have a global perspective on the problems that we're facing, and that helps us bring awareness to the daily decisions that we make. And I think it's important to remember that all of this started, this huge global organization, all started in Neche's little villa there in Rome. And this helped generate or get some of the interest of members such as Jane Goodall, Deepak Chopra, and Bill Gates. And to conclude, the next slide I have the beliefs that were listed officially for the club, which I thought were very nice. And that is the club we run.
Hello, my name is Courtney Olsen. I'm the Italian Club PR officer. I'm going to start with the Italian stance, and then I'm going to transition into like another traditional like folk dance. Alrighty, so Italian dance. Dance has been a huge part of Italian culture for many centuries. This is a labor of painting of these women dancing and this woman playing a drum. And in traditional, like, early dances, a drum played, like, a big part. It was very, like, interactive, very similar to, oh dang, was it Stephen who said it was very similar to, like, acting, kind of? It was a show for me. They would interact, the dancers would interact with the drummer, and they would kind of try to, like, out-dance out from each other. Okay. Next. Design stand. Dance manuals made their appearance around the 15th century,
revolutionized traditional forms of dance into different forms, where this like circle chain dance transitioned into like livelier dances with like higher technical music for couples and groups. Okay, next slide. Okay, so since the feast dance was kind of created and established before a time of recording stuff, there's not a lot of like visual aids for how to perform the dance, but one of the modern day like examples of the dance would be the tarantella, and it's traditional to southern Italy, and the dance name varies with region, so in like Sicily it's a little bit different than it would be in Naples. Back to 1100 BC. It was named after the wolf spider bite, and wolf spider being the tarantula. And the tarantula bite was actually highly poisonous, so after being bitten, the person who was bitten would go into like a hysterical condition or like a hysterical state. And part of the dance is, or the purpose of the dance is try to like cure the person who's been bitten by the spider. But it has turned into like a courtship dance for couples. Alright, next slide. Okay, so associated with the dance is the myth that if you're bitten by like a tarantula, you're gonna poison and go into this like hysterical state, and that the only way to cure you is through like this lovely dance of like the interaction between several dancers and the drummer. So this is kind of like a description of what happens during the dance. I'll read it aloud. The victim, which is referred to as the tarantata, was almost always a woman, but never a high-ranking lady or wannabe aristocratic upbringing. Once bitten, the tarantata would fall into a trance that could only be cured by fencing dancing. People would surround the victim while musicians would play mandolins, guitars, and tambourines in search of the correct rhythm. Each beat would have a different effect on the tarantata, causing various movements and gestures. Once the correct rhythm was found, it was almost certain that the tarantata was cured. Alrighty, so the next slide. We're gonna watch a video of it, and then after the video, we're gonna try to dance it, y'all.
Thank you. Thank you. What?
I get the kick touch tip and then the arms.
Much deeper appreciation for.
No, it's this sci-fi.
And then you're going to move into a circle and join.